Theodore Schoening is president of the Moscow School of Social and Economic Sciences and professor emeritus at the University of Manchester.
I think one should begin at the beginning. Very often when it comes to complex issues. And the beginning is in the past. I think in this sense it is important to look at all those issues which were mentioned and will be mentioned historically and see the history of it as a major element in our understanding of what is happening. It history of it not only in terms of what happened, but also in terms of the way we understood those things which were happening. I think so that the issue we are to discuss, the issue of sovereignty, it has at its background the issue of different classes within society and confrontation of classes within society. And that is where we should go for the beginning. And I think in this sense, already in the times more or less of Marx, or slightly earlier, there was an issue which was discussed warmly in those days, and yet it is still with us. It is the problem, as they defined it, as of class in itself and class for itself. I think that Via Campesina is a major expression of class for itself, an effort to turn what is objectively a class type of entity or class type of reality into a weapon for political action and turn it into something in which a major part of what is happening then is the process of self-definition of such groups and such classes, because the strengths and the weakness of such things lies very often in that issue and around that issue. And this is the major significance of Via Campesina to all of us. It is an effort of Campesina to understand itself. And it may play, I hope it will play, further a major role in what is happening to us and to the world. I think that when it comes to that, if we understand this class in itself and class for itself, and the process which is happening, and the mechanisms which make class in itself into class for itself, we shall, despite the fact that the concepts are 100, 150 years old, they are the concepts which are still alive and central to our understanding of what is actually happening before our very eyes, inclusive of this conference of ours. I think that when one defines it this way, one should also define one more thing. The word was not yet used, not accidentally, and it is central. We have to define what are the forces, intellectual, political, which stop this process of turning of class in itself into class for itself in our problem, in the set of our problems, that is, in the problem of agriculture today and different countries, etc. It is, the word is progress. I think that fundamentally the last 150 years went under, in the shadow of the idea of progress, of firstly the necessity of progress, secondly of the reality of progress, and certainly of progress being the only index and measure of what is good, of goodness, if you want. Because all the other things are not good. And if you put an index of progress on them, then if the index says yes, you are fine. If it means death of people, if it means hunger, if it means destruction of rural life and of urban life, if it means whichever we accept as negative, it stopped being accepted as negative the moment you put on it the label of progress, which is necessary, and therefore don't fight it, because you cannot fight something which is necessary and which is positive, because somewhere in the future, far future, it will resolve all problems. Just by progressing along those ways, we shall have them resolved. Just wait a little bit. And this, just wait a little bit, a generation, a two gen, maybe two, and everything will be fine. Just things are moving. They are moving in the right direction. And around progress, of course, it's the progress is measured most often by economic indices of income or some national income, etc. But not only. And here, something very important. Rapidly, the definition of progress gets narrower and narrower. It is economic progress. Suddenly, you lose all the other things. Many years ago, I was trying as a graduate student to define for myself what is peasantry. I mean, many people tried it, and many people will try it in the future too, because it's an important issue somewhere where at the beginning of your research work. I then suggested that it's family farming as a method of economic production. It is village life as a fundamental environmental characteristic. It is a specific culture which goes with it and ties it together. And it is belonging to the lower classes, to the plebeian part of society, being below, not being above, which is very important. I think even today, I still feel that was a useful way to define peasants as peasants, which is extremely important, because only when you define reasonably a phenomenon, you can work with it. You can find the methods to study it. Otherwise, you are left with words which are empty and not words which mean. Amoeba words, Ivan Illich many years ago defined it as amoeba word, which changed the form, and therefore you cannot know what it is, and you cannot use it as a method of work with facts and not with some sort of vague expressions in vague words. Now, I think that in this sense, to me at least, the theory of progress should be defined as it stands, should be defined as a major ideological enemy, which you have to face and outface. Because without outfacing such powerful views which are accepted by majority and yet never mentioned. I was listening to our opening. Nobody said the word theory of progress. Because somewhere people are uneasy with it, but they still don't quite name the difficulties related to those things. Now, I would like to say here also of the problem of studying things. I stopped for a moment because one can always turn it into purely academic exercise. What is a problem, say, peasantry or something? What is it? Well, it's something which you learn on Tuesdays, but between 11 and 12 in a class. This is peasantry. Now, in this sense, the capacity not to see things which are obvious is partly stopped by powerful idioms like tear of progress, and partly stopped by simple illiteracy, not seeing things, not trying to understand things as they are. In this sense, the ability to people to study peasantry for 3 years in the university and never go to the village, to one single village, is one of the most unbelievable and extremely powerful instruments to stop us from seeing things. And I think that fundamentally, once again, the significance of Via Campesina is hopefully the ability to make people go to the villages, to look at what's going on, to look at what is and what is changing, because you have to look at what is and what is changing. And only when you do it, you clean yourself from particular type of stupidity. When you very seriously debate things, very hot-bloodedly debate things, which you have never seen, but in statistical tables or on your desk, bits of paper lying there, but never walking into a normal village and feeling the smell of it, and the all which goes with it. I think that there's one thing more which is important here, which is a general thing. I was talking general things on purpose because after reading the papers, I got the bunch of papers and read them with interest. I must say, after reading those things, I was left with kind of feeling of not being satisfied by them. Somewhere I didn't feel the issue the way I thought I should feel the issue. We are still not there. And in this sense, I think one of the things which we must establish within the field of peasant studies, if there is such a thing, is to improve the methodology of studies. I know it because I know what the Russians achieved in the previous century, beginning of the previous century, when because of a variety of structural reasons, like the local authority of Zemstvo, like the way the intelligentsia worked at it, etc., they did produce a series of methods of study which changed the nature of the studies, because it was not go into the villages and look around. It's not look at the statistics of production. It is something which is in between and much more than on this, because it puts together our indexes of study. The Russians did manage to produce a massive understanding through methods which were new, which did not exist in other places, and which are still possible for use, but must be developed further. This is obvious. It cannot be a set of methods which study everything on national level. It must be something which brings into the study the family unit and the local unit and the regional specificity Only then you can begin to work. But you bring such, you see only things you expect to see, in a way. You must, to study them, you need methods, specific methods to study. And methods to study industry will never work fully in conditions of agriculture and villages, which is extremely important. I think that in this sense, a major issue which will have to be discussed between us, discussed further in the future meetings, etc., is to develop methodology which works. Methodology which works, which is not just description of what I have seen, but methods to which help us to understand what is the specificity of it and what is the peculiarity of it. I think I was warned that I have 5 minutes by now. It's not five, it's four or something like that. I would like therefore to end by a document just read by me for the first time, to my shame, which is the Neo-Zapatistas in Mexico, in Chiapas, declaration of what they think is the reality, the peasant reality, and there, because they are peasants, definitely, and what all that means. They put a list which, to my belief, is important. Who are the main enemies of that movement? And they put there two things in their list of enemies. One is neoliberalism. And that is the one, the all-known and often repeated by now, because one of the things which were achieved by Via Campesina and other such structures was to get into the brains of many people in the industrial West the idea that neoliberalism is dangerous. It's a major danger. In parallel, in at not ideological but political level, to the theory of progress. But there is a second thing which was never mentioned, but by us as yet, and it is good to mention it. It's humanism. There are two things they are calling for: fight against neoliberalism and defense of humanism. And I think while fighting against whichever we have to fight, we should not forget the central element of what we fight for, which is humanism. Thank you.